So for the purposes of demonstration, here I have a Galaxy S3 with NFC and a user card which has got value on it. The first thing I can see is that I want to load money onto my card, and I have the loader terminal up. It says, how much would you like to load? You have £24.65. I would like to load £5, please. It'll say, put the card on the back and now put in your username, password, and perform the load. So here now the phone is acting as an ATM, the load is complete, and we now have a new value on the card. In this example, I'm going to be using the phone as a merchant terminal, universal terminal. I want to buy something for £1, enter, and then the user places the card to the back of the phone. £1 is deducted from the card and put on the merchant terminal. I can check that by going to the wallet app and seeing how much I've got on the card, and sure enough, I've now got £28.65. In this final example, I've got a combination of a game and a merchant terminal in an end user device, so that when I play the game, I'm able to buy in-app purchases such as an extra life for 10 pence directly from the card, and so that when I return to the game and resume, I have my extra life. Hello, my name is Ram Banerjee from a company called Transaxiom, and we deal with digital cash. People always ask me, why digital cash? Isn't that something that we tried in the mid-90s and it didn't work? And they'll be right. In the mid-90s, there was a huge plethora of devices that were trying to do electronic money using smart cards, contact and contactless smart cards. Visa itself had 7 different types of platforms, all of them interoperable, or not. So nobody really got it right. The biggest trial, I guess, was won by Mondex in Swindon and other places, and that never really got anywhere. So why bring up digital cash now? Really, 20 years later, you could say it's a problem that we need to solve, because digital cash is needed more than ever. Why? Mainly because the majority, and this is amazing, the majority of the world is unbanked. And we often sit here in the West and say, so what? Well, the so what means that we're ignoring between 35 and 40% of the Western world population. There's 50 million people in the United States alone that are either unbanked or poorly banked, which means that they really don't have much in the way of banking services. And why is that important? Because banking services provides you with a payment mechanism other than physical cash. It provides you with all the remote payment mechanisms such as debit cards, credit cards, checks, and so forth. So the majority of the world is cash only. And cash only means that they are into face-to-face transactions. And they're never going to get to a position where they can find buyers further away that will take value, a greater value from their goods. They can't find sources of goods further away to be able to buy to make a greater return. So it's physical cash that keeps the cash users poor. If we want their lot to improve, then we have to provide a digital cash mechanism. Much of the success of the West has been as a result of electronic commerce. But there is no e-commerce without e-money. And therefore, we need to provide an e-money mechanism so that somebody can go and buy a USB cable on Amazon for 99 pence, delivered, instead of having to get on a bus, go to a shop and buy it for $9.99 elsewhere. We want somebody poor to be able to buy a plane ticket online in very much the same way as other people. The majority of the planet are connected. They're connected because they're mobile phone users. So they do have mobile phones, it's just that they're physically cash limited. And you can't screw down the cash tight enough to send it down wires. Unless we can get that majority of the planet coming up and to wanting e-commerce services, we as a planet don't thrive. We need those consumers just as they need financial products for the betterment of all. As they say, a rising tide lifts all boats. But there's another reason for digital cash. Whereas we've got away from very small value goods, I mean, you could say sweets and newspapers still require very small items, there are a whole host of things that still require repetitive small value. And main ones among them are things like transit, which is a physical face-to-face transaction. And then there's virtual ones, such as games, such as video, music, information. It's the internet that's created a demand for pay-as-you-go consumption of virtual content. And at the moment, this is done very badly with the only remote mechanism we have for payment, which is debit and credit cards. So it does it very badly with them. Digital cash is needed because if I want to buy an article from The Economist, which is only for 20 pence, then I want to be able to spend 20 pence with them rather than having to deposit £10 with them and then wait to spend the £9.80 on other services. So I want a mechanism of digital cash payment on the web. And that's what Transaxiom does. We do digital cash. How do we do it? We build the infrastructure required for digital cash. And digital cash effectively means that a user who has value can transfer that value to a merchant. That merchant can then accumulate that value and redeem it with the issuer of that money. And it is the issuer that loaded the value to the user in the first place. So, Transaxiom builds user systems in the form of secure smart cards so we can load value onto these cards. It builds merchant terminals in the form of applications on phones, and it builds an issuer hosting system in the cloud. And the issuer then connects to the rest of the banking world. We do all of that as a supplier of technology, and our customers take it over from that. And you'll say, well, isn't that what Oyster is? We have Transport for London has a system called Oyster for transit ticketing. You get an Oyster card with value on it, in this case pounds, and the merchant is effectively the gate at the underground station or the bus. Yes, and there are such systems in their millions around the world. The problem is, with such systems, every merchant device requires a security module called a SAM, Secure Application Module. It's a security device that's sitting within the merchant device, whether it's a gate or a terminal or whatever, that collects the electronic value from the end user. That is what stops these systems from becoming interoperable. If London Transport wanted Oyster to be freely available to taxis and kiosks for suites and newspapers or for parking, one of their SAMs would have to sit, this is an electronic device very much like a SIM card, a mini SIM card, would have to sit inside every merchant terminal. And those would have to be managed. It's an enormous security headache. What we've done within Transaxiom is that we've eliminated the SAM. We've taken away the security requirement of the merchant terminal, yet still be able to take a transfer of value from the user to the merchant offline, not been possible before without a SAM, to do it fast, below 300 milliseconds, not been possible before without a SAM, and to do it securely so that the merchant is not able to defraud the system by saying he's collected more value than he actually has. We build the entire system so that this merchant terminal can be any computing device that connects to a user. It could be a Wi-Fi box that's giving you megabytes of data per pence. It could be a vending machine. It could be a set-top box that allows you to pay per view. We have provided a digital cash system so that this can work locally using the card, or through your phone, the merchant can actually be on a website. So finally, you can pay 20 pence to get your Economist article. How does the system work? I like to say magic, but clearly you're not going to believe that. So how this value transfer system works without a SAM is the subject of our next video. Hello. My name is Ram Banerjee. I'm from Transaxiom, which is a company that specializes in the supply of digital cash systems. Digital cash is effectively physical cash, but made electronic. And just like physical cash, digital cash is a stored value system, which means that you carry the value with you. Typically, in the form of a smart card. Any secure element will do, but this smart card is the easiest and the least expensive way of carrying around digital cash. It could also be used in the environment of a SIM card or a secure element within a phone. But in today's case, we shall talk about a contactless smart card. Now, the way that our protocol really, and it's a patented protocol, is different to anybody else out in the market. And our closest relative is really transportation systems, where you'd be carrying value on a contactless smart card and tapping in and out of buses and trains. The way that ours is different to anybody else's is that we don't have a security module within the merchant terminal to collect value as you go on making payments. Despite that, we can perform very fast, and that's less than 300 milliseconds, transactions securely and offline. Nobody else can do this. And I thought I'll show you today how we do this. Central to what we do is the concept of the one-way function. The one-way function is a very simple mathematical device which says that if you start from a given point, then if you go to the next element, you're able to do that using a mathematical function that here we'll simply call f, which allows you to go from the previous to the next one with a relatively simple calculation. And you can do this until the end of your chain. Let's say the chain is n units long, and you perform this function every time to go
to the next element in the chain.
The beauty about these functions is that it's very easy to traverse forward in the chain, but practically impossible to traverse backwards. And as a result, these things are therefore called one-way functions. We use one-way functions quite extensively. And there's three components to our system. There's the issuer, and I will draw this in quite a large square. So there's the issuer, who owns the system and is responsible for its policing. And as you might expect with any system, the first thing that you do is you start off with a secret number. And this secret number is rather than number, it's probably better to just call it a key. This secret key is generated, obviously, randomly. And this key is shared with the user's secure smart card. So this is done at the time of personalization. So the secret key is personalized into the smart card. This secret key is valid for a particular batch of end user cards. So whereas this is the issuer, this is the user or user's card. Secure device, contactless. So we have then one more function available to the issuer, and this function is called the generator function. And this generator function produces within the issuer, within the security of the issuer, what we call a pre-image. Now the input parameters to this pre-image is a series of items known as, collectively, as the seed. And the seed comes from a combination of data that the issuer has and data that is provided by the merchant. So this is the merchant. The merchant is going to be the receiver of value, the user is going to be the sender of value, the issuer is going to be the generator of value. The merchant, one time and one time only, registers with the issuer and is provided with a merchant ID. And then the merchant gives various parameters to the issuer, such as I want to accept £1 coins, I want to accept this many. It's almost like a merchant going to a bank and say, I'll be taking lots of change today. Can you give me 7 plastic bags for £1 coins, 5 bags for £2 coins, and I'll need a bag for 50p, 20p, 10 pence, and so forth. And what the issuer does, it generates the equivalent, the electronic equivalent of these bags. And it does so by taking this pre-image and creating the image that is the end of the one-way chain using the function F repeatedly. So this is the end image. And these two items are placed in a data block, which is typically about 32 bytes long. And this we call the end counter.
And this encounter is sent to the merchant device. And this encounter has within it the seed and the image. And a whole series of these encounters are sent for every currency type, for every denomination of notes and coins it wants to receive, and for every set of cards. Card batches can be 100,000. So you may have a few hundred of these keys, of these encounters. Within the merchant terminal. But even 1,000 of them is only 32 kilobytes. So it's not a huge memory requirement. So what happens during a transaction? So this encounters, this is all generated initially at the start of day. This has been done at personalization, and the card has been issued to the consumer. The consumer can go online. This card does have a unique number that the issuer knows, and there's a loading protocol by which we can create a balance. And this balance will have value in it that is contained within the secure card. So what happens is that a typical transaction, let's say that this encounter is 100 long and is meant for £1 coins. So the encounter is literally the equivalent of a bag meant for £1 coins that can hold up to 100 £1 coins. At the moment, it's got X100 in there, which means it's the end of the chain, and the end of the chain represents zero value. If there was a X99, that'll be equivalent to £1. And X98 would be equivalent to £2. So the end of the line, if it's a chain that's 100 long, is equivalent to £0. So as you go up the chain towards its beginning, so the value of the chain representation rises. So what happens is that at the time of payment, the merchant effectively sends the encounter to the card. It's almost like the merchant saying, here's my current bag of money. I want you to put some money in there and give it back to me, and I'll be able to weigh it and know that if you've stuffed two more £1 coins in it. Because knowing the secret key, and the card also knows the generator function G, the card is able to create the pre-image. And say that the merchant wanted a £1 payment from the card. What the card does, it goes down, calculates the length of the chain until it reaches the image that is being provided by the merchant. In this case, because the merchant had £0, it would be X100 that the merchant will be sending it. And it reaches X100 down here. The fact that it's reached X100 before the length of the chain has expired means that that's a genuine merchant. Because the merchant provided this image, that image could only have been generated by the issuer. So as the payer, have authenticated the merchant as being genuine. And because the merchant wanted a £1 payment, sent that command in. what happens is that having reached the image that was sent, we then go back to minus one. We go back to x99. And that image, x99, is sent to the merchant. The merchant is incapable of generating x99 because it doesn't know how to create the beginning of the chain. Because to do so, you need the G function. The G function is only available in the security of the issuer and the security of the user card. What the merchant now does, it performs the function F, which it does know. Everybody knows the function F going forward, and it reaches x100. It then takes that result and the image it started off with and says, is that true or false? And if it's true, if they are both the same, then that means that the merchant has been paid. And he knows that he's been paid one unit because he took the result of this, performed the one-way function once, and got to the same image that he had before. So now he knows that the card was genuine and that the card paid him one. Doesn't know the identity of the card. In fact, no value has been transferred, because what happens is that the user balance here will simply have £1 deducted from it before the x99 was sent. So if this were to repeat, then the x99 will now take place of the image. And because the merchant has now got £1, he's literally got £1 coin in his plastic bag, or the electronic equivalent. He'll now give x99, it'll go down to x99, go back one to x98, give x98, it'll take it forward to x99 and say, yes, I've been paid £1 again. Which means that the payment is not based on the content of the message, but the context of the message. If you repeat £1 transactions using this mechanism, then gradually the responses will be higher and higher pre-images until that counter is full, and then it automatically goes to another counter. And in this way, we need no security within the merchant device. You can actually duplicate counters, but you can only redeem them once with the issuer, because the issuer will know that this counter has already come to me, because there is a unique ID with every counter, and it can calculate that, and it says that you've already redeemed this once. In very much the same way, you can take a bag that's got £2 on it, go and redeem it, keep that bag until you go to the top and redeem it again, and the issuer will say, well, you've redeemed £2 from it before, I'm now going to give you the rest of the money. And in this way, we need not have a SAM within the merchant device. The issuer knows the identity of every user, knows the identity of every merchant. The user can authenticate the merchant, and the merchant can authenticate the payment. Yet there is no ID information being pushed from the user to the merchant, as there might be in a credit or debit card transaction. There is no user identifiable information. Only the value is transferred. And as a result, this system has no concept of ID theft. Therefore, this merchant can be any device in any public environment. It needs no special security, and the entire merchant software, the merchant terminal software, can just be a downloaded piece of software running within an open device such as an NFC phone. I hope that's been useful. If you have questions, as always, feel free to get in touch with us. Thanks very much.